Okay, if you would, open your Bible tonight to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. You know, this morning we observe the Lord's Supper in this church. And the Lord's Supper is a memorial of the New Covenant or New Testament. It causes us to remember the broken body of Christ and the shed blood of Christ. And of course, His blood is the blood of the New Covenant. And Paul says very plainly in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that the Lord, the night that He was betrayed, took bread, break it, and He took the cup, and He said, "This cup is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." And then in our second hour this morning, I preached about the eternal promises of the New Covenant. And the New Covenant is in itself an eternal covenant. It's called an eternal covenant in Hebrews 13. And everything about the New Covenant is eternal. You know, everything about the Old Covenant was temporal. Everything about the New is eternal. We noted that it has an eternal high priest, an eternal salvation, eternal redemption, eternal perfection, and eternal inheritance, and many other things. Now tonight, what I want to talk to you about are the heavenly blessings of Hebrews. We talked about the eternal blessings this morning. We're going to talk about some of the heavenly blessings. Now our text tonight is the same one we used this morning, Hebrews 8, 6. "But now hath He," that's Christ, "obtained a more excellent ministry." And you know, that ministry that He obtained is He obtained it when He was raised from the dead and went back to sit down at God's right hand. That's where His ministry began as the high priest of the New Covenant. The New Covenant did not take force, could not take force, until He died. A testament is a force after men died, not before. And so Christ died, buried, went back to heaven, and began a new ministry as the minister of and high priest of the New Covenant. It says, but now hath He obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also He is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. The word "better" appears many times in the book of Hebrews, and it's used in contrast with the old. Everything about the New Covenant is better than the old. And one of the better things about the New Covenant is that many of the blessings are heavenly. They're not only eternal, like we talked about this morning, but some of them are heavenly. Look first of all at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews 3, 1. It says, "Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus." Now, that verse is addressed to holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. So right off the bat, we can see that Hebrews is addressed to heavenly people. Heavenly people. Now, the Old Covenant had an earthly calling. They were called to go out of Egypt into the Promised Land. But the New Covenant saints have a heavenly calling. You know, for example, we are seated in heavenly places. Our conversation is in heaven. Our hope is in heaven. Our Savior, our God, are in heaven. We lay up treasure in heaven. In other words, what that Promised Land was to the Old Covenant saint, heaven is to us. And that's why the things and the stuff of this world should be of no interest to us. We are heavenly people. And it also says we have a heavenly calling. Hebrews is written to people, it says right here, who are partakers of the heavenly calling. Calling. That word calling means vocation, profession, trade, occupation, employment. Again, the word calling is defined as your vocation, profession, trade, occupation, or employment. Well, as new covenant Christians, our lives is devoted to heavenly work. We have a heavenly vocation or job to do in this world. You know, we got a heavenly commission to evangelize the lost and edify the saints in this world. We have a heavenly gospel sent down from heaven to prepare us to live in heavenly places. Our prayers are heavenly. The prayers we pray are directed toward God's temple in heaven and not the temple in Jerusalem as the old covenant saints did. Answers to our prayers come down from heaven. Our Bible is heavenly. The Bible we believe and preach came down to us from heaven itself. Our Savior and King is in heaven. We look for Jesus to descend from heaven. We have a heavenly body. We look for a new body from heaven. We have a heavenly kingdom. Paul said he was preserved into the heavenly kingdom of Christ. And the kingdom we will live in throughout eternity will come to us out of heaven. And we've got a heavenly throne to bring our needs to. And at that heavenly throne, we find help and grace and mercy. So the new covenant saint are heavenly people with a heavenly calling. And that's why you and I are told not to set our affection on things below, but on things above. We're heavenly people with a heavenly calling. And then again, notice Hebrews 12. We talked about this one this morning a little bit. But the hope of all new covenant saints is to live in a heavenly city. We not only have a heavenly calling, but our hope is to live in a literal, physical, visible, genuine, heavenly city. Hebrews 12:22, he said, "But you have come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels." Notice it's called heavenly Jerusalem. The word heavenly appears right there. "To the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel." Now here in Hebrews 12, what Paul does, I've said many times, that he kind of cracks the door open for us to take a look inside of that heavenly city. And what he shows us here are the occupants who now occupy that city, who live in that city. And we find right here in Hebrews chapter 12 that New Jerusalem is the present location of all the dead in Christ. He calls them the spirits of just men made perfect. That's the dead in Christ. Some of them you know, you're related to. Some of your friends, some of your close relatives. I got a mother and a father. I got a son that's there. He's one of those spirits of just men made perfect. So the dead in Christ are right there in the heavenly city, New Jerusalem. You know, when Paul said to depart and to be with Christ, this is exactly what he's talking about. Because this is where Christ is. We know that from verse 24. Jesus Christ, the mediator of the new covenant, is located in the heavenly city, New Jerusalem. And so is God the Father. God the Father is the judge of all in verse 23. That's the Father. And in verse 24, Jesus the Son is in the city. And New Jerusalem is not only the present abode of the dead in Christ and of God the Father and God the Son, but it's the present location of the church of God. Notice that? He said, you come to the General Assembly of and Church of the Firstborn, which are written in heaven. You know, God got a church in both heaven and earth. The one on earth, you're in it right now. That's those who are still alive. But that church of God in heaven, that's the spirits of just men made perfect, the dead in Christ. So we got a church, the church of God, saints in both places, heaven and earth. And the ones above are in that city. And New Jerusalem is the future hope of all saints. You know, you go read Revelation 21, you find the names of the 12 tribes of Israel on the city. That's the old covenant saint. But you'll also find the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb on the city. That's the new covenant saint. So eventually, all saints will live in that city. We also know that New Jerusalem will come down from heaven to the earth in the future. Now John sees that in Revelation 21. He sees the city coming down from God out of heaven, and it lands upon the earth. And the earth it lands upon is the new earth. God will make new heavens and a new earth when Christ comes. And in that new earth, there'll be no seas, oceans. And that new earth appears to me that it will be bigger than than what it is right now. Much bigger. You know, 3/4 of the earth right now is water, oceans. In the new earth, no oceans. It's all land. And this city will come down and land and be established upon this earth. We know that from Revelation 21. And also, John describes the splendor and the beauty of New Jerusalem in Revelation 21 and 22. You know, if you were going to live in a house in the future, say you're going to move to a new house, I would imagine you would go and take a look at that house, wouldn't you? You look it over. You want to know what your new house is going to look like. Well, if your hope is New Jerusalem, read about it. Tells you everything that we can possibly know about it in those two chapters, Revelation 21 and 22. Tells you what the streets look like. Tells you what the gates look like, what the foundation look like, what the walls look like. It's a magnificent city. It's something we've never seen. You can't imagine. And I imagine John really had a problem trying to explain what God showed him. With the weak language we have today, he did his best. He did a good job in describing it, but I promise you this, the half was never told John. But you'll see in that day. That's the hope of all New Covenant saints, is a heavenly city. A city literally, physically, visibly in the heavens right now. Saints of God are there. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost is there. And not only that, but he mentions an innumerable company of angels. I left them out there in verse 22. That means there's so many of them there, you can't count them. And that city will literally, physically, visibly come down out of heaven to the earth out there during the kingdom of God. Now, something else that's heavenly, we touched on this morning, that's heavenly, that all new covenant saints enjoy, and that's our high priest. Hebrews 3:1 again. Hebrews 3:1. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. Now look at 10:21 of Hebrews. 10:21. It says, and having a high priest over the house of God. You know, in 1 Timothy 3, Paul refers to the church as the house of God. Here we learn there's a high priest over it, Jesus. Look at chapter 4, 14. 4:14, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Now that verse makes it plain and clear that he is a high priest in the heavens. You want to know what Jesus is doing right now? He's doing what high priests do in the heavens. Chapter 8, 1 and 2. Chapter 8, 1 and 2. Now the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest, watch it, who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. See that heavenly high priest. A minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched and not man. And then one more time, chapter 10, 21. We looked at this a moment ago. I'll read it again. And having a high priest over the house of God. Now, the people today, or any day, any age, who need a high priest, are people who have no access to God, and it's people that need an atonement for their sins. Well, that's everybody, isn't it? The high priest served both purposes. The high priest made intercession to God for the needs of the saints, and he made an atonement for the sins of sinners. So nobody is important as the high priest. Nobody. And that's why there's always been a high priest from Genesis to right now throughout eternity. You say, Genesis? Yes, there was a high priest back there. What was his name? Famous man. Melchizedek, a famous creature, I should say. There's always been a high priest. Why? Because men need access to God and men need an atonement for sins. That's what the high priest does. There's always been one. And even though the law was abolished, the office of high priest was not abolished. Never. We still need someone to intercede to God in our behalf today. And we still need an atonement for sins. And in the new covenant, Jesus Christ is ordained as the high priest over the house of God. And according to Hebrews, he is much better than the high priest of the old covenant. And even those before the old covenant. Christ is much better than any priest at any time who ever lived. Notice, if you would, chapter 7. Notice this comparison that Paul makes between Christ, the high priest, and the high priest of the Old Testament. Chapter 7, 22. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. And they truly were many priests, Old Testament priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. They died. But this man, Jesus, because he continueth ever, never dies, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, and then for the people's. But this, Jesus, he did once, when he offered up himself. Now, notice this about Jesus and the old covenant priest. In verse 26, it says that Jesus Christ was holy and harmless and undefiled. That cannot be said of the old covenant priest. In verse 23, 24, 25, it says he lives forever and will never be replaced. The old covenant priest died and had to be replaced over and over again. In verse 27, Jesus offered one sacrifice for sin and sat down. The old covenant priest offered many sacrifices for sins and could never sit down. We said many times there was no chairs in the temple, in the tabernacle. Why? The priest's work was never done. Why? The sacrifice could not take away sin. And in verse 28, Jesus is consecrated and perfect, and the old covenant priest were not. He's a much better priest than they. And that's what Paul is pointing out in these verses. Also look at chapter 9, 24. 9:24. He said, "For Christ has not entered into the holy place he made with hands," that's on the earth, "which are the figures of the true, but in the heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us." Now, here's another contrast between him and the old covenant priest. The high priest of the old covenant appeared in the Holy of Holies once a year. Just once. But Christ, our high priest, lives in the Holy of Holies constantly in the presence of God for us. I think a lot of people overlook that fact right there. That's a tremendous promise. Christ is not in the holy place made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but in heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. And he appears in the presence of God for us continually, not once a year, but continually. And Jesus Christ is an eternal reminder of the sacrifice that he made for our sins, and as a constant advocate to plead our case before God. He ever lives to make intercession for us at the throne of grace. Paul one time said in Romans 8:34, "It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us." And he does it day and night in the Holy of Holies. Not once a year, but 24 hours a day. Think about that. You've got an advocate 24 hours a day standing for your cause, pleading your cause, interceding to God in your behalf. So you have a heavenly high priest. We have a heavenly city. And then something else. Look at chapter 4. Chapter 4. And note this. We have a heavenly throne. Chapter 4, 14. "Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Now it says in verse 14 that Jesus is passed into the heavens. And that throne of grace in verse 16 is where he's at today. That throne is in heaven. A heavenly throne. So, the throne of the new covenant is in heaven. And it's a throne of grace. Grace. Jesus Christ, our high priest, is there. And when we come to that throne, what do we find? Grace, mercy, and help in our time of need. And I tell you what, we can rejoice that we have a throne of grace to come to. I mean, what a world would this be if God sat on a throne of justice? If that was the only throne that God sat on today was justice, no mercy would be ever shown to anybody. But thank God, the throne of God today is a throne of grace. And at that throne you find grace, mercy, and help, not judgment. You know, not a smack on the head, but grace and help and mercy. And of course, every day we need what God offers us at that throne of grace. We need what he offers. We're sinful. So we need what? Mercy. we're feeble and need help, we'll find both at the throne of grace. We'll find mercy and help. Mercy to sinners, help to the feeble. Also, the way we approach under the throne of grace is by prayer. Every time you pray, you're approaching a throne. You may not be aware of it, but you are, because that's where prayer is heard and answered from, that throne. Now, if we approach the throne of grace by prayer, then how necessary prayer must be. See? Every man's a sinner, and he should pray for pardon. Every man is feeble and weak, needs help. Every man is tempted, he needs deliverance. We can find all those things and a whole lot more at the throne of grace. Prayer. And also the throne of grace is easy to be forgiven. I mean, the great high priest is there to answer any prayer for forgiveness. Anytime anybody today asks God to save them, forgive them, he's standing right there at the throne of grace and he will do it. And at the throne of grace, every temptation can be overcome by the one who overcame every temptation. See, that's what it says. We have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace. In other words, when you come to the throne of grace in prayer, you're coming to prayer to a high priest that's been tempted with every temptation you ever had and some you didn't know about. So he knows all about temptation and overcame every temptation. And so consequently, he can tell you and show you and empower you to overcome any temptation in your life as well. So at the throne of grace, every temptation can be overcome by the one who overcame all of them. He stands evermore to aid and assist us in our temptations. And I tell you, if people today are not pardoned, and if they fall into sin and ruin, they had themselves to blame. Christ, the great high priest, stands at the throne of grace at all times, and he's willing, more than willing, to pardon anybody that calls. And he's willing to help all, and he's willing to show mercy and grace to all who ask for it at that throne of grace. Oh, I should say, new covenant saints, or heavenly saints, and they have a heavenly calling. And New Testament saints, New Covenant saints, have a heavenly city. Our hope is to live one day in a literal, physical, visible city in the heavens. And because we're heavenly people, we have a heavenly high priest. He's set there in the heavens right now, carrying out the ministry of the priesthood. I heard a man one time say that you can't really understand everything that Christ is doing today unless you read the book of Hebrews. And when I first read that, I kind of didn't pay attention to it. Now I understand what he means. Because Hebrews describes the present ministry of Christ in heaven. I can tell you exactly what he's doing in heaven. This whole book tells you he's seated at the right hand of God in heaven as a high priest. And anything and everything that high priests do is what he does right now. And I tell you what, he's pretty busy. He must be. He must be. And we have a heavenly throne. Our throne is heavenly. And that throne is a throne of grace, not justice, not wrath, grace. And Jesus is right there at that throne. And we approach that throne by prayer. And the Lord hears our prayers and answers them according to our will. And if you're weak as a Christian, you can gain strength at that throne. If you're ignorant like me, you can approach that throne and gain wisdom. Whatever your need is as a Christian, whatever it is that you need that will help you to become a better Christian, like overcoming temptation, you'll find that help at the throne of grace. And if that's true, shouldn't we pray a whole lot more than what we do? In other words, you approach the throne of grace by prayer. If so, then how important prayer must be. Don't leave it out of your life. Don't think you can live without it. And I tell you what, some folks act like they can. Folks, the first thing that I do in the morning, I don't even get out of bed, I'm already praying. I know how weak and feeble and ignorant I really am. I pray for wisdom all the time. I pray for strength all the time. I pray for guidance. And I admit before God, I'm probably the worst person in the world. I'm the most ignorant person in the world, the most weak person in the world. And so I ask God for strength and wisdom. And I bring petitions to the throne of grace of people I know that need help, healing, advice, strength, and comfort. That's where you bring your petitions, at that throne, and He's promised to hear them. He's promised to at least hear them. That don't mean He'll answer all of them, but if they're according to His will, number one, and number two, if they will then somehow give Him glory, if He answers it, you stand a good chance of having your prayers answered. And when prayers are answered, they come down out of heaven. It's like God giving you a bouquet of flowers from heaven. That's what I compare answered prayer to. Isn't it wonderful to have a direct answer to prayer? Pray about something, I mean specifically, and have God answer it specifically. All of that takes place up there at that throne of grace. That's where prayers are heard. That's where they're considered. And that's where they're answered, right there. So, as a New Covenant saint, we not only have eternal blessings, but we have heavenly blessings. We're a heavenly people with a heavenly calling, and all of our blessings are eternal. We have an eternal covenant. That's the New Covenant. There'll never be a time in the future that the New Covenant will go out of existence or expire. And we have an eternal redemption, an eternal salvation, we have an eternal perfection, and we have an eternal home and hope and inheritance in the coming kingdom of God. God has been gracious to us, has He not? Very gracious. I don't know why He's been so gracious to us. That's one of the things I cannot figure out, but He's a God of love, and His love is beyond ours. I mean, His love is just on another level. And that proven to be so by the people He blesses and saves and helps and assists today, right?